Today I'm talking to Kirill Ilinsky, who's the managing partner of Fusion Asset Management based in London. We are talking as ratings agencies increasingly look at downgrading the debt rating for the entirety of the Eurozone, including financially healthy countries like Germany. Mr. Ilinsky, thanks for talking to us today. Now, this is a crucial time for the Eurozone. Old Europe is pushing for more fiscal unity, and meanwhile the UK is backing away from it. What's the solution, do you think?
I think for United Kingdom it's an interesting game, because really if you see how economy developed here, manufacturing went down, so manufacturing changed from 25% to 10%. At the same time, financial sector grew from 5% to 10% GDP, so now we are on very equal footing. So it's not only about euro, but it's about overall contamination of financial system. And clearly, as financial system, as London is a financial center, this is very important for the United Kingdom. Therefore, there are two sides of the game. One is political and economic, and another is financial infrastructural one.
And should politics really come into what is essentially an economic decision?
Absolutely. Politics should come in what is essentially economic decision, because politics is a concentrated expression of economics. Really, European Union was a part of a larger political project which took almost 50 years since the end of Second World War. And this unification and fiscal unification, which people are talking now, it's just the last or latest step in the overall process. Therefore, every country needs to decide how closely integrated it wants to be in this political process, and the line of United Kingdom so far was actually very reasonable. If you see what happened in Europe recently and how much United Kingdom would be affected, what was done so far was extremely clever.
But what about this kind of forcing of the issue? I mean, you say that fiscal union is the natural result of political union, but isn't it the case now that the political union and the fiscal union is kind of breaking up, and people like Merkel and Sarkozy are trying to force it back together?
This is true to some extent. But at the same time, we need to remember that Germany is, at the end of the day, they are paying. And if you look at Italian situation, if you look even at French situation, then France has a real risk of losing AAA rating, and therefore putting at risk ESFF facility, which effectively was created to solve this financial problem. It's definitely a different game for Germany and for France. And timing-wise, it's different as well, because for Germany, Merkel sees it as a marathon. And really, this sort of problems which were accumulated during 30, 40 years of debt expansion and uncontrollable spending, if you like, cannot be sorted out in 3 months. For Sarkozy, however, it's they have April elections. So it's either happening in the next 2 months, and very publicly and politically, or he has a real problem in his own country.
How much economic logic is there in throwing everything at preserving the euro?
There is economic logic there. But question here is it the same euro? Same countries which were accepted for political reasons, and at the time of cheap credit, then the issue of control was not so high on the agenda? Or it's better to have smaller club of real euro countries with a stronger economy and stronger currency. So it's probably less a question if Greece is going to stay in euro than Italy going to stay in euro. Because if we talk about Italy, Italian banks, they have around 100 billion of equity. They bought 300 billion of government Italian bonds. They also bought 200 plus billion of bonds of other financial institutions. Then we have 450 billion or 500 billion of deposits on their balance sheets. And if Italy goes out of euro, and these obligations are all in euros, so you either need to restructure or it will affect the banking system. Banking system will bring recession in the country, but also in the whole euro, because then you have 1.7 trillion euro of household and firm loans, which will immediately trigger chain of events across not only Italy, where inflation and unemployment is high already, but it also will immediately trigger similar effects in other European countries. So losing Greece and losing Italy, it's two different games.
Let's move on and talk more generally about the financial crisis. People are blaming the bankers. They're still doing it. It's what you hear most often on the news when people talk about the financial crisis. Do you think it's had any effect on the way that bankers operate?
It definitely has an effect. We can talk about the effect because there are several sides. There is the regulatory side. There is increase in required capital. Then there is obviously old question of easy money and control of conflict of interests, and they're all different angles of the question. In terms of how banks are regulated, banks definitely better regulated. But on the other hand, you need to look at profitability of banks. 40% of income of banks coming from non-interest related activities, which are services, which is basically investment banking. So now if you start pushing regulation on and regulating hardly these things and trying to split investment banks from corporate side, clearly there are a lot of synergies originally in the structure that will disappear. So just cutting and regulating will kill that part of services, which will drive down profitability of banks. If you then ask to increase capital ratios, then it will drive the profitability of banks even lower. Then you start regulating bonuses. What's happening? It's a very competitive industry. So what banks did, they cut the bonuses because they agreed with governments to cut bonuses, but they immediately increased salaries 2 times. So now when people say, yeah, well, I'm not getting my bonus, you're actually getting 2 times salary, which means that fixed costs in banks increased enormously. So now we need to cut people. That's why 20-25% of workforce either disappeared or will disappear very soon, which means it's not going to be supportive for the bank business. In principle, you're supposed to generate more revenues, not cut costs.
And so where are we now in terms of getting out of financial trouble?
It's a very long process. It's if we look back how, say, post-war debt was watered down and how it was dealt with, it took 10 plus years, it's 20 years. It's a very slow process. There is a huge amount of debt, and the United Kingdom is probably the worst country in terms of total public and state debt, which is now, I think, around 450% of GDP. So worse than Italy and worse than states, although there it's most publicly known issues. There is also hidden debt, which is coming from pension liabilities. We don't talk about it much, but actually it's a huge amount which sits as a liability for corporates and sits as a liability on councils and so on. There is no easy way. We overconsumed, we borrowed this debt, we need to effectively pay back. So there are different ways to pay back, but neither of them are going to be pleasant. And one of lines of thoughts is what people call financial repression, which means it's a negative real interest rates, so inflation high, nominal interest rates are low. It's a cap on interest rates, government borrowing from captive clients, so pension funds. If you have to invest in highly rated, and highly rated is your government, then you need to give money to your government at any rate, whatever. And then government effectively using this money to pay back the debt. And then it will bring even closer relationship between government and banks, closer regulation, closer oversight. And in this sense, academics believe that you can pay 3-4% of debt a year. And when you take the number which you need to achieve, divide by 3-5%, that's the amount of years you need to get out. It's not 1 year. We're not super positive on next year in terms of it's not going to be 2009 100% rally. We don't think so. Every stage in a financial crisis is bigger scale and considerably more difficult to get out. Because every time you're putting more money, efficiency of putting this money is going down. Money disappears from the problematic area in areas which were not affected. So going into emerging markets, increasing labor costs there, increasing inflation, so making emerging markets less competitive, therefore less able to pull developed markets from the crisis, and more money politicians put in the system, they're effectively killing the centers which were supposed to drag the whole economic system out of the crisis.
That all sounds very painful. During a time like this, where do you think people should be keeping their money? Are we talking about gold or a mix of currencies or what?
Yeah, I think Keynes said at some point that it's a beauty contest. So it's not that euro is bad currency. It's maybe some other currency even worse than euro. And it's a question of comparison. Clearly, it depends on your risk profile. In terms of overall asset classes, we do believe that high-yield fixed income offers interesting opportunities. It's very difficult to bet on gold, because gold, it's a mix between FX, risk-averse asset, and metal. So it's difficult to predict, but gold worked particularly well in recent years, both as a hedge and as an investment. And absolute return strategies, it's unlikely that equity going to produce as much return as it was before, fueled by easy money. So really, absolute return strategies is what people and pension funds go if there is a low yield environment. And for that, we can learn from Japanese. So Japanese are in this situation for 10 plus years. So if you look at the proportion of pension funds in Japan allocating to alternative assets, if here it's 3%, 5%, there it's up to 30%. Because they know that government bonds are not going to make them money, and equities probably not going to make them money. So we need to go for something more longer term, but then clearly trying to extract the absolute performance rather than benchmark performance.
Kirill Ilinsky, thank you very much.
Thank you.